Grace. Hallelujah. Good afternoon, Stratford. It's another sunny day. We are so happy that the Lord God has blessed us with such a fine day. I woke up this morning and I was so excited that the God of heaven and earth, the possessor of everything I see, everything I can imagine, all things that were, all things that will be, He that has no beginning, He that has no end, the God that began the all beginning, decided to grace us or grace me with such a wonderful morning, and I have the pleasure of sharing it with you. Good morning, Stratford. I just come with a simple message from the Lord God. Someone was talking to us, interviewing the great footballer Ronaldo. Maybe he doesn't play for your team, maybe you don't like him. Well, I don't watch football, but I was listening in on the conversation, and they asked him, how is your football? And he talked about one of his coaches that he studied under, that mentored him, and that the coach always told him, keep his football simple, and that if he keep his football simple, he'll be one of the best footballers on the earth. So I took that to heart. I like to keep my messages simple. And last time I spoke here, I talked about how much God loves you. And I was thinking about that message, you know, and I was hoping that some people here, they really got to understand what that message is. And I quoted first John 3:16, that God so loved the world that he gave. I want to talk about someone that is very dear to my heart. He wrote over two-thirds of the New Testament. Paul, formerly known as Saul. Paul was what you might call a terrorist. In our day and age, if he was alive right now, they would call Paul a terrorist. Because he was going around taking people and kidnapping them, putting them in prison, and ransoming them. So Saul was a terrorist. Was a despicable terrorist. He felt he had the right stuff. You know, he felt he had a reason to be a terrorist. He felt that he had, he was a man with a mission, a man with a cause. He believed so much that what he was doing, he believed it so much that he thought that he was doing it for God. He thought that he was taking people and killing them, persecuting them in the name of God. Saul was a terrorist. And he decided to promote himself, that he heard that some people, some customers to his terrorism, and he was going all out to get them. So he went to some leaders and he got some letters to say that he has a right to take these people and to kidnap them, put them in prison, not just them, their families, and every single one connected to them. So Paul was on his journey, was a road to Damascus. Maybe some of you might have heard that story, what happened on the way to Damascus. Just stay with me, I'm going somewhere. So this terrorist called Saul was on a horseback ride to Damascus. He had a lot of soldiers. They were armed to the teeth. It was this time to have some AK-47s, some bazookas, maybe a tank. What? Going to perform terrorism. And on his way to Damascus, he says in his own words, there was a bright light, brighter than the noonday sun. You know, the sunshine we have here in London, it can really blacken your eyes. It will not warm you, but it will shine light in your eyes. It was brighter than that. The sun shined from heaven, brighter than the noonday sun, and he heard a voice. It was so bright that he fell off his horse. He fell down from his horse, and he heard a voice. There was a mighty shaking, and a voice spoke from heaven. Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? That's King James English. I'll try and translate. Saul, Saul, what the heck are you doing? Why are you terrorizing people in my name? Why are you terrorizing me? That's what God asked him. Saul, Saul, why are you terrorizing me? Why are you a terrorist? And Saul was cut to the heart. Who are you, Lord, that I'm terrorizing? He said, I am the Lord Jesus. Now, how come I was terrorizing you? Say, if you terrorize anyone in my name, it's as if you're terrorizing me. You're a terrorist. But I will change you. I have a plan for you. You see, why would God be interested in a terrorist that was going about performing his terrorist act? It's exactly what I said last week. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Someone said and asked us a long time ago that, how can you say, you Christians, why do you say this? Why do you say that God loves sinners. I said, yes, he loves the sinners, he doesn't love the sin. And I began to explain it, that if a child, you had a child, a son, a daughter, and they were under 5 years, 2 years old, and they soiled their pampers, and you had to clean them up, you would not throw out the child with the dirty pampers. The same thing here. There is no one created on the face of the earth that is created for evil, or created for darkness, or created to experience lack, to experience want. Now, if you are experiencing any of the things I have heretofore mentioned, I tell you that you were not born to experience it. You were not born to experience depression, to have a mental health challenge, to have a whatever challenges that it may be, to be in debt, to be in want, to be homeless, to be without food, to be in fear of what you're going to eat, what you're going to wear, what you're going to put on. You're not born into it. Something happened, and I'm going to get there. Saul was a terrorist. He was going to go and perform an act of terrorism. And God stopped him along the way and asked him, why are you terrorizing against me? And he asked, who am I terrorizing? I thought I was doing this thing in your name. He said, as often as you do this, you are terrorizing them. You are terrorizing men. You are terrorizing me. See, God equates it. That's how personal this God I'm talking about. I've come to talk about a relationship, about you having a relationship with this God of heaven and the earth. I've not come to talk about religion. I've come to talk about something that is higher than religion.
Amen.
Something higher than religion. Something that will bring you into the family of heaven, walking upon the face of the earth. For the enemy comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Anything you're going through, the mission statement is that you'll be depressed, and you'll be so depressed that you reach a point that you try to think about taking your life. Now, that's the enemy's mission statement. He has come to steal from you, to kill you, and to destroy your life. But Jesus Christ came with his own statement. He said, I am come that you might have life and have it to the overflow.
Amen.
So, what God was telling Saul, that this is my statement, is that you might have life, the good God kind of life. Not that you die, just die and go to heaven, but you experience the good God kind of life right here on earth. Well, how? By being adopted. Now, when I say adopted, it's not in the sense of someone that is not biologically related to you. You go to an adoption agency and you ask and you sign some papers and that child now becomes your child and you become the legal guardian or the adoptive parent of that child. In the Bible sense of adoption, when God receives you into his family, he changes your very DNA. Someone say DNA. Your very DNA, at the core of you, something changes. That is why God, I can say without any fear, that God loves sinners. Why? That you might come to him and that he might change you at the DNA level. He might change your atoms. That is why it doesn't matter what color you are, what background, what country you're from. When you come to Jesus, you are changed right down to your atoms. You are changed right down to the DNA level. You become a new creature, someone that has never existed before. The person living in this earth house called your body changes. Hallelujah. You become a new person. You become a life-giving spirit. Adam, the first Adam, was a living soul. But the second Adam, the last Adam, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, he became a life-giving spirit. And as many as accept him, they receive that same DNA. They receive that same transformation. It's a spiritual transformation. It happens on the inside. And you begin to live life from the inside out, not from the outside in. External situation and circumstances do not have a hold on you. They can't get the better of you. You cannot fail. That's what I'm getting at. It is impossible for you to fail. Emmanuel, what are you saying? I know people that have failed. I know some Christians that they don't have it all together yet. How can you say that if I get this DNA, that I won't fail? I tell you, you can never fail. You can only give up. If you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you can never experience failure. You rather just give up. You let go. You just give up. Talk about Abraham. Abraham was a man that was looking for a child. He left his father's house at the age of 75. If it was here in the UK, you say, man, you really gave your mother and your parents a run for their money. You stayed in their house, eating their food, and rent free for 75 years before you left with your own wife. But the Lord God told him to leave his father's house and go to a place that he would tell him about. And he left. And he said, I will make you. I will bid unto you your quickly increasing money supply. So he wasn't afraid. And he began to experience miracles, not just financially, but even in his body. But it took him 13 years to experience it. He experienced it when his wife, Sarah, was 90 years old and he 100 years old. He held on to that same promise. What was that promise? That the Lord God himself would send someone to die on his behalf. The Lord Jesus Christ. And I immediately believe this promise. The Bible says it was accounted unto him for righteousness. Amen. The same thing happened with brother Saul. Saul was hit with sunlight on his way to Damascus. He was going to commit an act of terrorism because he was a terrorist. And a light shined from heaven. And a voice thundered. And he got up from there and obeyed that voice. What am I saying right now? I'm coming with a simple message. As many of you that shall hear this message, will you just listen and accept this little message? On the road to Damascus, they said every single person there saw that light and every single person heard that voice. But only one person was recorded to have a changed life. That is the same Saul that was a terrorist. And he had a changed life and became Paul the Apostle, who wrote two-thirds of the New Testament. And over 2,000 years till now, we are still hearing about it and its exploits. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
How many of you will listen and hear and just pay attention that there's somebody that loves you more than you love yourself? He created you. He knew you when you were formed in your mother's womb. And he ordained you that you might go forth and have the good kind of life. But heretofore, things have not been going the way you wanted. Maybe you're in debt. Maybe you're in want. Maybe you have a physical challenge. Maybe you have a health challenge. Maybe the doctor gave you a report that you do not like. Or maybe there's a loved one that has a report of cancer. I was just speaking to a friend of mine. She's from Uganda. And she had been believing God for a right of stay. You can imagine how the situation here in the UK can be when you want to have your right of stay. Fortunately for me, I was born here. My mom's Jamaican, so I have a red passport. But she was believing for a right of stay. And we got together and we started to pray. Why? The Bible says that, ask of me and I shall give you whatsoever. God, the God of heaven and earth said, ask of me. You have not because you ask not. So we decided to ask. And she shared a testimony with me that she has been given an indefinite right of stay. We just asked. Were we perfect? No. In my own estimation, I think I could be taller. I think I could do with a bit more chest hair. Just joking. But God, in his own estimation, he sees me absolutely flawless. Why? Someone died and paid the price for me.
Hallelujah.
Someone paid the price for me. And that price the person paid was enough to satisfy God. You need to understand that. That's what I'm talking about. Someone has paid the price for you. And that price that was paid for you was enough to satisfy. Anything else you try to do will not be enough. You will always come short. You will always come just below the mark. You will always miss it. You always miss out. You will always not have all your ducks lined up in a row. Some T's will not be crossed. Some I's will not be dotted. Rather, accept someone else. That's why Paul became a terrorist. He felt he still wanted to help God do some things. So he was going about committing acts of terrorism. And God spoke to him. He shined a light from heaven. But the Bible says it was only Saul that was changed. It was only Saul that listened. It was only Saul that hearkened. It was only Saul that believed. I like to use the word believe. Many people use the word believe. Believe means an action word. He took it to heart that, Lord, how can you say I'm a terrorist? I thought I was doing these things on your behalf. Have you been doing some things, living life a certain way, thinking that you were doing it on behalf of God? And deep down, you wake up and you're not sure. You're not sure. I asked some friends, if hypothetically you died and when you died right now, would you go to heaven or hell? And they would always answer, I think I'll go to heaven. And I would ask them why. Say, because I'm a good person. I've done some good things. I've been a nice person. I have been able to keep half of my list that I wrote in January. All the things I said I was going to do, I've been able to do more than half of them. So if I die today, I think I'd go to heaven. Unfortunately, that is not the entrance exam. That's not the ticket. Your ticket will not be punched. It's not enough. It's not enough because there's somebody else still doing much more than you. So God decided to equalize everything. Anyone that is going to get there only has to believe. Take it to heart. The same way Saul the terrorist took it to heart. Many people were part of his entourage. Many of the soldiers, they felt that, yeah, we're going to get paid. Some of them felt, oh, wow, this guy is not going to Damascus. We're not going to get paid. So they left and they did not obey. But Paul believed. And because he believed, he received the gift that keeps on giving, the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's all I'm saying right here. I believe that these little words have pierced your heart. You have thought about them. And I know that even as you are hearing my voice, I understand certain spiritual principles. You will think about these words. You will consider them upon your bedside. They will be like a man turning on the inside of you. What will happen if I fall down dead now? All that I have been doing hitherto, how I have been living this life, is it really the good life? Is there something more? Do I have everything exactly the way I want it? Is there much more than this? Can there be more? Do I deserve more? To all those answers, I say yes. You deserve more. You deserve the best. And that's what I've come to declare to you this afternoon, in these few words. Amen. You have been singled out for the best. You have been singled out for the best. You have been singled out for the best. God himself, the maker of heaven and earth, he that puts that not just, you don't have to, some people are afraid of police. All they can do is put you in jail. After jail, what next? Rather, you should be afraid of the person that not only can he put you in jail, but even after you come back from jail, even after your body is dead and in the ground, your soul will still be reckoned unto him. That is the person you should be afraid of. But I'm here to tell you, you don't need to be afraid of that person. That person loves you, and he has made a way of escape for you. He has punched your ticket. He has wounded his son. I want to read this scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, the words of Paul as told him by Jesus. Verse 23, he says, "For I have received of the Lord," talking about Jesus, "that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, 'Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you.'" The body of Jesus was broken for you. He was broken for your sin. He was broken for your poverty. He was broken for that sickness, that ailment, that report that the doctor gave you, that he says that is a terminal illness and that it will never, all you can do is manage it. The body of Jesus was broken to take care of that ailment. I do not mean small words. I'm talking about divine healing. If you believe that as his body was broken, that report, that sick report, that report of death and sickness, that report of poverty, that report that makes you lose sleep and has caused you to go on some antidepressants, that report says, Jesus Christ said, concerning that report, "Take, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Remember that I have paid the price, that my body was actually broken just for you, that I have paid the price just for you. Only believe." Take it to heart. The next verse, verse 25. "After the same manner also he took the cup and he supped, saying, 'This is the cup. This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me.'"
Amen.
Verse 26. "As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come." You do show his death, our victory. His death, our victory. His death, our victory. His death, our victory. You are free. You are considered innocent. If you believe, right now, my words, the Holy Ghost will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you, effecting a healing, a cure in your body, in your finances, in your situation. Jesus Christ was asked, "How can I do these miracles?" In John 6, verse 29, or was it verse 27? Say, "How can I do these miracles? How can I experience miracles?" Say, "Only believe. Only believe that my body was broken for you. Only believe that my blood was shed for you. And if you believe it, it shall be made manifest in your body, in your members.
Amen.
If you believe that, just join me in this little prayer. And I'll speak these words over you. And I tell you, without, I have no doubt in my mind, the Holy Ghost will come upon you.
Amen.
The power of the Most High will overshadow you. A healing and a cure will be made manifest in your body. I tell you, if there's any sickness in your body, or any report, or any situation that has made you to lose sleep, right now, if you believe, what does it mean to believe? Believe is an action word. It's to take it to heart. That these words I have said unto you, that his body broken, your freedom. His body broken, that situation that you are under, broken. That sickness you are under, broken. That debt that you are under, broken. If you believe, as I said again, I am not mincing my words. The Holy Ghost will come upon you.
Amen.
The power of the Most High will overshadow you.
Amen.
A healing and a cure will be made manifest in your life. Father God, I thank you for this precious ones. I thank you for Stratford. You said unto me that I will make my words in your mouth like fire. And I'll prepare the people like wood, and there shall be lightning. I'm not talking about arson, no. I'm talking about the fire of the Holy Ghost. That same fire that was burning that bush that Moses looked at, and the bush was not consumed. But everything that was wrong with Moses was consumed. And Moses became greater than the prince of Egypt. He became a prophet of God, a child of heaven. So much so that he could not be killed. Even in 120 years, he still ascended a mountain. I tell you, some say, is it that easy? Yes. It's so easy that sometimes you feel as if it cannot be true. But it is. I hear, I'm telling you from experience. I've seen the miracle working power of God in my life and in the life of people I've prayed for.
Amen.
And the life of people that believe like I believe. I say again, for those that are hearing me, it will not take a few minutes to listen. If you believe that his body broken so that you might be declared innocent, the Holy Ghost will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you, effecting a healing and a cure. I sense that some people that are watching me online, the same power is coming upon you in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Why? There is no distance in the spirit. As many as should believe. Father, I speak over these ones that have taken my word and that you are prepared. I asked of you and you said you shall give me people. There are many of them that have believed. Let the Holy Ghost come upon them. Let the power of the Most High overshadow them. Let a healing be made manifest in their body. Let the healing begin to be activated. I rebuke every sickness and every trouble and every trial. I come against every lack of sleep. I declare sleep unto you. He gives his beloved sleep. And I speak sleep to you now in the name of Jesus. The many of you that are believing for a good night's rest, today you shall sleep clearly than you have ever slept before. How do I know this? I just know it. Take me at his word. Because I do not come on my own authority. But authority of him that has sent me. Let the Holy Ghost come upon you. Let the power of the Most High overshadow you. From the crown of your head to the sole of your feet, mighty gushing flow of God's power. As many of you that want to accept him as your personal Lord and Savior, we have some materials here. Please walk up. If you're a bit shy, when I turn off the mic, walk up. Talk to me. We're always here. My brother is always here. Take a little material. Read. Ask questions. That's what I'm actually looking for. Ask questions. You have some questions. Man, look, is this thing true? This thing you said, are you pulling me on? Is this a con? Come and ask. Oh, thank you, Father. Well, many of you that I'd like to receive him, just repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I thank you because you came and you died. Your body was broken. Now I'm declared innocent. I receive you as my Lord. I receive you as my Savior. I take you at your word. I receive this life. Now I'm changed. I'm new. Accept me into your kingdom. Let me enjoy the good life. Let me experience it here on earth. And in the life hereafter, abundance of life.
Amen.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much.
Amen.
All right.
God bless you.